Blitzer, special live show, live situation room from Chicago. Wolf.
Brooke, thanks very much. Happening now, Bill Clinton on the Republicans, he says, will be most threatening to President Obama in 2012. Stand by for my one-on-one interview with the former president of the United States on the campaign, the economy, and much more, including a topic that made him get rather emotional. I'm Wolf Blitzer in Chicago. You're in the Situation Room. A game of chicken is playing out in Washington right now, a game that could do some serious damage to the U.S. economy. The former President Bill Clinton is warning that it will be a very big deal if Congress fails to raise the legal limit on the federal debt by August 2nd. I spoke with President Clinton at length here at the site of the Clinton Global Initiative event in Chicago. Do you think that August 2nd deadline is a pretty hard deadline?
I do. I know it's a hard deadline in the sense that just letting it happen will have, at the very least, a short-term adverse effect on our standing in the world, on our credit, on people thinking we're a grown-up country who know what we're doing. Now, how bad the long-term damage is will be determined by how quickly we remedy it, but since it's never happened before, it's impossible to be absolutely specific. But it's nutty. What you're really saying when you don't raise a debt limit is not you want to balance the budget in the future. It is, I'm sorry, I'm so mad I can't get my way. I'm not going to pay our past debts. And a grown-up country wouldn't do that. We can't afford to do that.
To our viewers, you're in the Situation Room happening now. Bill Clinton talks about the 2012 campaign, America's looming debt crisis, and the very dangerous crisis the country faces around the world. My one-on-one interview with the former president of the United States this hour. And this is a special edition of the Situation Room. We're live from Chicago at the site of the Clinton Global Initiative America Conference, where key figures from government, business, academia, they are gathered to try to tackle America's economic problems, and those problems are huge. This event is the brainchild, of course, of the former president, Bill Clinton. And I sat down with him today here in Chicago for a candid interview on the country's debt crisis, the 2012 presidential race, and much more. President, thanks very much for joining us.
Thank you, Will.
Good to be here at the CGI America. It's the first time you've done this as the U.S. economy is concerned. Normally, it's global issues, and I want to get to that in a little while, but let's talk about some of the big issues right now. Jobs, jobs, jobs. It's a crisis, a game of chicken going on in Washington right now between the president, the Democrats on one side, the Republican leadership on the other side. How big of a deal is this August 2nd deadline for raising the debt ceiling?
Well, because I haven't been in government in a long time, I don't know what options the Treasury Department will have if the debt ceiling is not lifted. My guess is they can pay the bills for a while, after which they won't be able to. So if we let that deadline come and go, and we really raise questions about whether our political system is mature enough even to pay its bills, I think it's trouble. I realize the idea of voting against raising the debt ceiling has always had great appeal to people. You know, even in good times, there's a bunch of people vote against raising it because it looks like a free vote.
When he was senator, President Obama didn't vote to raise the debt ceiling.
Yeah,
he regrets it now. He said that was a mistake.
Yeah, but you know, when you're not president and you think the votes are there, it seems like a freebie, and you can say, I did it to protest this. But there's a reason that most governments in most countries don't even think about having a vote on this, because they know that the reason we have to raise the debt ceiling is because of decisions that have already been made, not because of decisions that are going to be made. So we really can't afford to let anybody in the rest of the world who are willing to put people are willing to put capital in this country think that we don't pay our debts. That's like saying we may earn.
What would the consequences of the U.S. not paying its debts, going into default, if you will, or bankruptcy, whatever you want to call it, what would the consequences be for average people out there who are worried?
the most likely consequence in a hurry is that all interest rates would go up. And so for the government, that means that the deficit would increase more, that the debt would increase more because we'd have to pay more to borrow money to cover our debts. And you can't, those things don't increase in a vacuum, which means that interest rates on your credit card, on your college loan, on your home mortgage, on your car could go up. It could be a real problem.
This is a big deal.
In other words, it's a big deal.
And you think that August 2nd deadline is a pretty hard deadline.
I do. I know it's a hard deadline in the sense that just letting it happen will have, at the very least, a short-term adverse effect on our standing in the world, on our credit, on people thinking we're a grown-up country who know what we're doing. Now, how bad the long-term damage is will be determined by how quickly we remedy it. But it's since it's never happened before, it's impossible to be absolutely specific. But it's nutty. What you're really saying when you don't raise a debt limit is not you want to balance the budget in the future. It is, I'm sorry, I'm so mad I can't get my way. I'm not going to pay our past debts. And a grown-up country wouldn't do that. We can't afford to do that.
How do you resolve it? In other words, there is a compromise in the works, but it's going to be painful for both sides. The Republicans say they're not going to raise taxes in this current economic environment under any circumstances. Is there a deal if they hold firm?
Well, there may be a short-term deal. I don't think there's a long-term deal. Because what they're really saying is that the tax rates which prevailed on people in our income group, upper income people, when I was president, will never be allowed to
39.6%.
Yeah, will never
and it's
be
gone
allowed,
down to 35%.
Yeah, will never be allowed to go back into effect, even though those are the best economic years the country ever had. And the second 4 years was the only time since 1980 when the bottom 20% of earners' incomes in percentage terms went up as much as the top 20%. So their economic theory doesn't work. It's about their politics.
They're not going to vote. The House of Representatives, they're not going to vote.
Even
for a tax
Alan
rate
Greenspan,
hike.
A conservative Republican, says we ought to go back to those rates. So what they call a compromise is they take 90% of what they want instead of 100%, and that's compromise. And then the Democrats get nothing. And so I understand that. But I frankly don't think we should be raising taxes or cutting spending a lot right now. This economy's too shaky, which is why I believe what they should do is to try to make a 10-year agreement and set targets and work back from it. Because, and by the way, I'm not alone in that. The Bowles-Simpson Commission report, which was very tough on the specifics, requiring significant compromises from both parties, but quite detailed, recommended that we don't start this until the economy is fully in recovery.
Senator Rand Paul told me this week he would vote to raise the debt ceiling if there were some certain conditions, including a commitment for a balanced budget amendment. Is that a good idea?
I don't think so. And you know, I hate these deficits. We have
the governors have to deal with balanced budget amendments.
They do, but the governors don't have to deal with national emergencies either. The balanced budget amendments are very good for the governors because they impose fiscal discipline and they keep them from borrowing money, in a sense, to cover current expenditures. It'd be like a family borrowing money to eat dinner every night. That's what and federal government does that. But on the other hand, the governors are able to take on long-term debt in the form of bond issues, for example, as long as there is a revenue stream to cover that. We mesh it all together. When I was president, I appointed Governor Corzine, who was then in the private sector, to a commission to look at whether we ought to have an investment budget in America. And I still would like to revisit that. I wouldn't have any problem with a balanced budget amendment that covered current expenditures only and was suspended whenever there was a recession. But a national government has to be able to spend in a recession to overcome the collapse of private investment.
You've said this week here at your CGI America conference that there's $2 trillion sitting on the sidelines right now that banks, corporations, individuals have. They're just sitting on it because they're nervous about using that money, investing it to create jobs.
Corporations have $2 trillion in cash that they have not yet committed. They're American corporations with world operations. They haven't committed to overseas operations or to give back either in the form of dividends to shareholders or compensation to management and employees. They want to spend a substantial amount of that money here, but they haven't yet. The banks have more than $2 trillion in cash not committed to loans, to support loans, at conservative ratios of, let's say, 8 to 12 to 1. So now, in that $2 trillion is about $160 billion in potential direct exposure from bad mortgages. But the Bank of America settlement yesterday is a good indication of what I hope will happen throughout the market, because once they get that whole thing put into place, the really great things about that settlement were not in the news story.
Because if they use that money to stimulate the economy, get jobs going in the private sector, that would be wonderful.
Absolutely. Well, see, this money they're giving...
But you can't blame them for being nervous.
No, but the money that they're giving... Let me just say what Bank of America's going to happen. Bank of America will lose profits for 6 months, yeah. But by giving this money to the bondholders and the other people holding these mortgages that they sold, they also will acquire the ability to write down, or have someone for them write down, all the mortgages to their present value of the homes for everybody who can afford to make that kind of mortgage payment. And then for everybody else, it'll be clear that foreclosure is the only option. We could clean up the bank books, keep a lot of people in their homes that are still worried about losing them. And if everybody would follow this lead, this could lift an enormous economic and psychological burden off the country. So the banks have a lot of money. We've got to figure out how to get it invested.
Easier said than done, obviously.
Yeah, but I think green energy is one good way to do it. I still think we retrofitted every public building in this country, and all the major private buildings that are going to be here in 5 years, you can get all those savings guaranteed. All you have to do is let them be financed from utility bill reductions, which means there has to be a loan period that's greater than the 2 or 3 years banks are normally comfortable making them. And the government can make one or two changes and make that happen, and nobody would lose any money. You could finance all
the
work.
And in the process, you'd create a lot of jobs in the construction industry.
You create 7,000 jobs for every $1 billion you invest. It's the highest return you can imagine. And in construction and manufacturing, you get more than two jobs in the rest of the economy for every one job you create.
All right, there's much more of my interview with President Bill Clinton coming up. Up next, he weighs in on the Republican presidential field.
I like Governor Huntsman. I like Governor Romney. I think Governor Romney's doing a better job this time than he did last time.
He also has an explanation for Michelle Bachmann's soaring popularity. You're going to want to hear what he has to say.